Oh,
hello,
so
my dear.
Oh, thank you
I'm
for coming.
I'm so delighted to see you.
Oh, and you look absolutely beautiful. Thank you for coming.
Oh, well, thank you so much.
I'm so excited to have you come for tea here at Denali.
I knew. Nearly.
Yes.
Why on earth are we in the foyer having your tea?
Yes, I was certain you'd be questioning that. You see that the staff does not quite have the rooms ready as of yet, although I made sure I informed them. In fact, I made sure I informed the housemaid, Miss Doyle, and it seems there's been a bit of trouble, so the rooms aren't quite ready. So I thought this would be the best place for us to have our tea.
Nellie, do you realize it's 1 o'clock in the afternoon?
Yes. Oh, my goodness. Aunt Lizzie, I must speak to them. Yes.
I think you better speak to them immediately.
Yes, but I think just shortly we'll ring for tea, and then I'll make certain that you would like to speak with the staff afterwards.
All right.
Truly, I am sorry of this. Now, Mrs. Doyle.
Yes, ma'am.
Aunt Lizzie has bit of a concern that we are sitting in the foyer instead of having our tea in the drawing room or in the dining room.
I want to know, why on earth are we sitting here, Chilly? This is disgusting. It's 1 o'clock in the afternoon.
I told the maids, my maids, to finish it, but they didn't seem to do it.
Well, you are in charge, and you better do better.
Okay.
The room should be done early in the day.
Yes, ma'am.
Well, Miss Doyle, thank you. Thank you very much. And Aunt Lizzie, I'm sure you will agree that Miss Doyle did a wonderful job in setting our table and the delicious scones she has made for you. Miss Doyle, we will ring for you.
Thank you.
And she would like to speak to you later. I'm so very
sorry. Nearly.
Oh, yes.
You don't thank the servants.
Oh, well.
What on earth are you thinking?
Well, you know my free spirit, Aunt Lizzie. I've always been so very kind, especially, as you know, when I was growing up at home with Mother. She seemed to have the same outlook as you did, but I wished to be very friendly with them.
Well, you do not do that. Otherwise, they're going to get completely out of control.
Yes, you better stop it. Oh, yes, Aunt
You
Lizzie.
Have to run your house like a bee.
Yes?
As your husband, you know
busy
we
as a
love
bee.
Bees.
Yes, busy as a bee, and I shall take your advice, and I do hope that you will help me along here as I start the new household.
I will.
I must say, though, on my defense, both myself and your son have been quite friendly with the staff, and we haven't quite, put our stronghold on them as of yet, but we shall both work on it.
Well, I certainly hope you do.
We shall. Aunt Lizzie, I was wondering how things have been working out with the new chimney sweep, Douglas.
He's working out perfectly.
Oh, that's wonderful.
He does a beautiful job.
Oh, does he? Oh, I'm so very pleased. I know you were so concerned after Danny had to leave.
Oh, Danny. Oh, that man. He drove me crazy.
I should never forget about your story of him coming down your chimney through your fireplace into your bedroom. And you were in your wrapper, I recall. Oh, what a surprise that must have been.
It was a more than a surprise. It was disgusting. And also, he was very intoxicated.
Well, that's my other concern. Have you had any trouble with the drink with Douglas?
No, he's very lovely.
Very good. You know, I had many times been very concerned, thinking that with Danny having so much to drink, that he could possibly fall when he's on the roof. I suppose it's all in the best that he's been replaced.
Oh, I know.
But I have a question, and it's in regard to Douglas and Danny. I had invited Mother for tea today with you and I, but she absolutely refused, Aunt Lizzie. Would you be able to enlighten me in that? In fact, she was just very unkind and upset, and she says she just would not wish to have tea with Aunt Lizzie.
Well, I think I know why.
I sent something
here. I sent Danny to do her chimneys. And I believe he was a little intoxicated.
Oh, my. Oh, I could just imagine. And should he... Do you happen to know if he may have come down into her room as he did with you?
I do not know, but I have a feeling something worse happened.
Oh, Aunt Lizzie!
I know that you would enjoy that.
Oh, I did. Thank you so much. Well, it explains quite a bit why Mother was very adamant about not coming today. In fact, she said she didn't wish to have tea with us ever again.
Well, I think I did you a favor, didn't I?
You did. And, you know, in your defense, I told her that Douglas, initially she did try Douglas, and she, for some reason or not, she didn't find him appealing. And when he came straight from another job, he was full of soot. And she was upset of him being covered in soot, of all things, and this is his profession. So...
Well, your mother is a pain, you know?
Yes, I must agree with that, yes. So I do understand. Thank you, Aunt Lizzie. I'll have to share that with Thomas. I think after his past, all the years he was courting me and coming to Conway House and Mother not allowing him to see me, he'll greatly appreciate that.
Your mother was terrible, you know?
Yes, I recall all the times he came and you were very upset because he was not allowed to see me.
That's right.
And she sent him home, and all those calling cards, I should never forget. All those calling cards. I remember I saw the whole box you had shown me. Goodness, I'm so sorry, Aunt Lizzie. Well, we all know how Mother can be.
I know.
Well, I had so many things I wish to talk to you about. Thomas says I'm always going off in all these things, in all these different directions, and I can't stay focused. But I think of all the wonderful things I wish to speak to you about. After all, when he calls you in the evening on the telephone, he doesn't let me have a bit of time at all. So I try to write everything down before we meet
Good.
One another. Things are going very well, I must say, at the yard. Has Uncle William informed you or Uncle Tom of everything that's been happening?
No, not really. They've been so busy, but you can fill me in.
Well, as you know, in January of this year, the work on the gantry was started for the Olympic class liners. Well, just recently, within the past week or so, Thomas had taken me to the gantry. Oh, Aunt Lizzie, you must go and see how it's coming about. In fact, it's nearly finished. And he had taken me to each of the areas where both Olympic and Titanic will be. And I looked aft towards the harbor, and it seemed to go on forever. And he had me imagine what it would be like once the ship has actually begun being built. And he also showed me an artist rendition of the keel blocks and the ribs, how they will take shape. I must say it looks like the spine of a person, and then the ribs come out like our rib cage. But I must say, Aunt Lizzie, it'd be quite difficult to put a corset around that.
Well, aren't you a wonderful girl, you know, saving what your husband's doing?
I encourage him in all he's doing.
That's lovely.
I must say, I'm not fond of his late hours. He goes to work in the dark, and he comes home in the dark. But I choose to wait for him, as a good wife would. And many times we're having our dinner quite late, I must say. He's been teaching me about a lot of the new things being put in place at the gantry. Aunt Lizzie, there was something there that looks like gigantic lobster claws. And he said they are the hydraulic riveters, and they will hang from the gantry. And I saw about three of them hanging already, and then several on the ground they're waiting to install once it's complete. Of course, he said the hard-to-reach areas would be hand-done by the men near the turn of the bilge, and other areas that would be difficult for the hydraulic riveter to reach. I know I talk all this shipwright talk. I'm sure you don't appreciate it.
Let's change the subject.
Yes.
I brought something for you.
You did? Oh, that's a lovely bag. Was that one of the ones you bought in Paris?
Yes, it is.
Oh, it's just absolutely lovely. What have we here?
What have we here is a charming christening gown.
Look,
isn't that lovely?
Oh, how precious. Oh, Aunt Lizzie, it's in such wonderful condition. Oh, look at the lace at the end.
This has been in the family for about 200 years.
Oh.
And Thomas wore it as a little baby.
My Thomas?
Your Thomas was christened in this gown.
In this gown.
Oh. Isn't it lovely?
It is absolutely adorable. And look at the embroidery. Oh, and this was all hand done. Had you had any work done yourself?
I did that little embroidery there.
Oh, it's just so precious. And the pin tucking. Oh, it could be let out to any length.
It's beautiful.
And may I ask, did this gown, was it worn by all your children?
Yeah, all my children.
All of them. It's absolutely precious.
And it's for you. Oh. And I hope in the future there will be a little one.
Yes, we are talking
of it. I'm kind of preparing you.
Oh, thank you, Aunt Lizzie. We are talking of it.
I have something else.
Oh.
Something that is so sweet and so special. Little shoes.
Look how
the Thomas
tiny.
Once wore.
Tommy wore these. They're so small.
And he grew to be a big man.
Yes, your big son. I cannot even imagine your big son wearing these. Oh, and I would understand that John, James, Nina, and Willie wore these as well.
Yes, I want you to keep them and pass them down.
Oh.
And you pass down the christening gown too.
Aunt Lizzie, thank you.
My pleasure,
thank
dear.
You. Oh.
And I hope the blessed day will come when I will become a grandmother.
Well, I have some things to actually speak to you about. And I think I noticed that there's maybe two buttons missing. I will have Tilly put them on the shoes, and they will be ready to go.
Do you think Tilly could do that?
She's very talented. And the shoes will then be ship-shape, as Thomas would say.
Wonderful.
Yes, thank you so much. It's quite ironic that she would bring these. Thomas and I have been talking again about children, but it seems we are at a bit of a discrepancy once again, and I wish to speak to you about this. You see, he still believes that the mother should raise the children and that there not be a nanny or governess about. And I truly wanted to speak to you about this and hear, to have your opinion on this.
My opinion is you have to have a nanny.
Thank you, Aunt Lizzie. And if I'm not mistaken, you had both nanny and governess.
That's right.
Well,
and you know something? You should have Thomas's nanny.
Thomas's
nanny.
Nanny
Booth.
Is she still in service?
She's still around.
She's still in service.
And she said to me, I hope Thomas soon has children.
Oh.
That I could come back to the family.
Oh, that would be lovely to have her.
Yes.
What do you think he would think of that?
He loved his nanny.
Very good, very good. Well, he's turned out to be such a wonderful man, such a giving, loving, honest soul. I shall have a talk with him about this.
Lovely.
And perhaps maybe when you speak to him on the phone at some evening, you can mention it as well.
I certainly will.
Thank you, Aunt Lizzie. I've been always keeping here at the table the beautiful brooch that Tommy gave me at the wedding.
It's a bee.
It was in the shape of a bee, yes.
This bee beautiful brooch. With diamonds and emeralds. It's absolutely beautiful.
And this is all I wore besides my wedding rings on the day of the wedding.
And you know, bees had a very special meaning to Thomas.
Yes, I wanted...
Did he tell you?
Somewhat, yes. And I've always wanted to know what the story is behind this book that seems to always be on our table at all times and seems to have grown its own legs and seems to walk from room to room.
He was fascinated with bees and how they work together to do beautiful things. Did he tell you about how he feels about the bees and how, I think, he used it in his architecture, the technique of the busyness of the bees, and how each person should do a specific thing.
That is.
Did he tell you?
Yes, he told me that the if you read the book, he just admires the way that the bees have their colony and the way that they work things. In fact, he said they were the number one society, as far as he was concerned, in here on Earth. And he did say he admired their great feats of architecture, which of course he has seemed to have worked into the work at the Yard. I was interested in finding out that the author, Maurice Maeterlinck, was a poetic playwright of all things.
Really?
Yes, and some of the book that I have read reads very much like many of his plays, but so very interesting and resonating back to humankind as well.
This book, he loved it.
The Life of the Bee.
He would read it from cover to cover to cover to cover. I used to say to him, Thomas, stop reading that book.
I remember you. I remember recalling as we were courting, you had said that when he finally does marry and he has his own place, that he must take that book with him.
But did he ever tell you what he did with the bees? In the winter?
No, I don't believe so. I would have remembered.
He had the bees outside. It was a cold winter's night.
As it is here in Belfast.
And you know what he did? He put all the bees under his hat and came in the house to warm them up.
Under his hat?
He came in the kitchen. They all came out flying and they stung the cook.
Oh my goodness. He was concerned they would catch cold.
Well, the cook got bit by a bee.
Oh, my.
Stung on her bum.
On her bum?
I was so embarrassed I had to call the doctor.
Oh, how embarrassing to have to call for that. Is she still with you?
No, she left.
Oh, my. Well, I would guess, see, Thomas had said there was a time or so that Uncle Tom had taken him to task out in the woodshed. Might that have been one of those times? Yes? Oh, Aunt Lizzie. As a compliment to you and to the nanny, you raised such a caring, loving boy, and I'm not in the least bit surprised.
Oh, well, thank you, dear.
That he brought his bees in to stay warm.
And he's a loving boy.
Yes. Oh, each and every day I look forward to him coming home, and we sit in the drawing room or in his office, and we sit by the fire, and I'm so happy to hear how his day has gone. And I can't wait till he comes home tonight, because I get to tell him about our great, wonderful tea we had here, and without Mother.
But you know, Nellie, I'm really concerned about the way you're running this house.
Yes.
You have to get in control.
Yes.
Especially with Tilly. You cannot say thank you to Tilly.
Yes.
You don't thank the servants.
Yes, I suppose that is one area that you and Mother do agree upon. It seems both Thomas and I have failed in that area of keeping the staff in place. I would, of course, be honored if you would help me address them as well while you're here today. Are you ready for any tea again?
Yes, I think so.
Would you like a spot of tea?
Another spot of tea.
And you haven't tried the scones as
yet? Yeah.
Oh, Tilly worked so very hard on them for you. A little bit of tea.
We will have more tea, Tilly.
And we have a great bit to discuss with you, most especially Aunt Lizzie, regarding your service.
Yes, ma'am.
You see, Tilly, when Aunt Lizzie entered our home today, while she was coming to the foyer, she looked in the drawing room and the dining room, and when she saw the dining room, she was quite dismayed at the table setting.
When I went into the dining room, Tilly, I noticed the survey pieces were in the wrong places. The wine glasses, the small glass is for the wine, white wine. Medium for red wine, large one for the water. You had the water glass in the front and the white wine over here. Everything was in a terrible muddle. You've got to put your stuff together,
Tilly, if you would move up a little bit further by the table here, because at times Mother has trouble hearing very well.
On top of it, when you put the pieces out of the china, everything has to be measured. You have to have a ruler, and each piece has to be a certain distance. So you have to remember this, Tilly.
I promise. I will.
This house has to be run a little nicer. Otherwise, your mistress will be in.
Should not want me shunned from society.
People will be talking.
And another thing,
in
Tilly.
In society, you cannot do that.
And another thing, Tilly, that Aunt Lizzie brought to my attention, and I think it quite important, that whatever expenses are going out, you know, for whatever things in the home, that you address them with me at the end of each week. I am considering a time for yourself to accompany Aunt Lizzie and I to possibly look at new gowns in one of Miss Lucille's studios. But I should not wish to go and risk our account being overdrawn. I'm sure you would not wish that for your mistress.
No.
So I do expect receipts at the end of each week, so I have a constant tally of what is going in and out of the house.
Also, Tilly, early in the morning, you come to your mistress with the menu for the day. And you have to approve of it.
Yes.
And if you don't like something, Nelly, you have to speak up.
I shall. So that's understood, Tilly.
Yes.
Very good.
Yes, ma'am.
And this upcoming weekend, Aunt Lizzie is going to be having the family picnic at Ardara. Oh. And she said that it would be wonderful if you would attend and help her girls, her servants, and possibly learn some things yourself and help them.
Thank you.
You think you could manage that?
Yes.
You really do?
Yes.
You don't get nervous?
Yes.
Well, you put yourself together and do a good job.
She shall.
I will try.
Well, that would be all.
Thank you.
Oh, and Tilly, if you wouldn't mind, would you call Aunt Lizzie's carriage, because soon she'll have to be heading home.
Yes.
Thank you.
There's another thing I want to mention to you. When you have a dinner party and you have guests, when you are talking to people on the right, you have to turn your head right. Then, if you talk to somebody on the left, you have to talk left. And your guests have to follow what you're doing.
Oh.
They have to go right or left or right or left or right. And you have to make sure that you are turning in the correct place where you are talking to a person.
I shall, and I suppose our neck and our head will be quite spinning by the end of the evening.
Well, don't make fun of it.
Oh, no, I shall not.
You have to do it.
Yes. Yes, and I will make sure that I go over with Tilly everything about winning to lean in and serve different people at different parts of the table. I mean, no, I did not mean any, no disrespect at all, Aunt Lizzie, not at all. But I would say, wouldn't you not agree, your neck would be quite tired by the end of the evening.
By the time you are through, you will know what to do.
Yes, yes.
So remember, right or left or right, and your guests have to follow suit. This has to be done. In society, you are in charge in this house.
Yes.
So remember that, Billy.
I shall, Aunt Lizzie.
And pull yourself together.
I shall, Aunt Lizzie.
And
thank
call
you.
Tilly. What the heck is she doing?
Well, she was calling your carriage.
Yes, she's taking her time.
Oh.
I expect my carriage here immediately.
It is waiting at the door.
Immediately.
It is.
And stop shaking, Nelly.
Well,
Tilly. Tilly, stop shaking.
Thank you for bringing the carriage.
You stop thanking her.
Oh, I just... Thank you for being here, Aunt Lizzie. Please understand that I'm new at everything, learning how to run a home. This has probably been the hardest thing in all times since we've been courting and we were married, in learning how to run your own home. Yes, I am quite aware of the way things were run at Conway, but I never did agree very much with Mother, so it seems both Thomas and I have laxed quite a bit, but I shall make you proud.
I don't mean to be strict, Nelly. I'm just trying to help you.
And you always do. Thank you. I want my society parties to be just as lovely as yours.
Thank you, my dear.
And next, soon coming up, I need to see a doctor. I've been having a lot of stomach trouble.
What?
A lot of stomach trouble. And many times I thought I was with child, but no, it's just been a lot of stomach troubles. So I'm going to go interview a Dr. Byers, and I was hoping that you would take the visit with me.
Of course.
Thank you.
I hope it's nothing serious. I'm really worried. Nellie, I hope you're okay.
I'm sure I am. And having you with me, I just feel that everything is going to be just fine. But thank you. And thank you for coming today. Thank you, Aunt Lizzie. Thank you. And I will let your son know that you are expecting his call this evening.
Yes.
You have a wonderful evening,
Aunt Lizzie. I will.
And I love that bag.
Cheerio.
Cheerio.